Were dinosaurs the first living beings on Earth? Or were there other animals before them? Dinosaurs ruled the Earth for millions of years, but almost no one ever asks this question. Who was there before them? How come we know so little about them? To answer, we will have to dive into a world now lost forever, traversed by strange and seemingly ill-assembled creatures, just as if nature was randomly experimenting with the most suitable forms for survival. Permian monsters, life before the dinosaurs. In the Upper Carboniferous Era, 300 million years ago, the world, hot and sweltering, was covered with vast, dense rainforests in which huge tree ferns, up to 45 meters tall, palms, and strange, primitive-looking trees predominated. Some of them reached heights of 40 meters, with a width at the base of 2 meters. The trunk wood did not yet contain annual rings. Often it was a simply hollow trunk, branched at the top with a dense crown. The atmosphere was saturated with oxygen, which promoted the phenomena of gigantism, especially in insects. Amphibians were the dominant terrestrial vertebrates, while in the oceans, sharks replaced the armored fish widespread in the Devonian. The Permian era immediately following saw the grouping of landmasses into a single supercontinent, the famous Pangaea, surrounded in turn by a single great ocean. The Permian began with an ice age, but the climate gradually warmed and the interior of Pangaea became desertified, although there was no shortage of colder periods. The dominant terrestrial fauna consisted of amphibians and increasingly reptiles, including the ancestors of mammals and the precursors of dinosaurs. Lakes were the lifeblood of the local ecosystem, pools that, like oases, loosened the grip of heat and wind. Animals of all kinds frequented them, which we would not recognize today, mostly amphibians. There were slimy salamanders, bigger than a dog, placidly waiting for fish to bite into the water. Or Pareiasaurus, squat quadrupeds with lumpy skin, much more robust in the front than in the back, resembling wacky reptilian football players. Small, fat Dicynodonts raced through the mud like wild boars, using their sharp tusks to pluck tasty roots. And over they ruled the Gorgonops, bear-sized monsters that occupied the top of the food chain thanks to the saber-like canines with which they slashed their prey. One of the bizarre creatures that lived in those swamps was the Diplocaulus, a salamander more than a meter long, characterized by long protrusions on the sides of its head, which gave its skull the shape of a boomerang. But that world did not only belong to amphibians. There were also giant insects like Meganeura, an outsized dragonfly that lived between 360 and 285 million years ago. The width of its wings could reach 75 centimeters, while its body measured more than 50 centimeters. The name, literally large striated, comes from its wings, which were characterized by very distinctive grooves. This insect was carnivorous and fed mainly on other insects, but also on amphibians such as frogs or newts. It was equipped with specially developed eyes, much like those of today's dragonflies, and strong, tough jaws which enabled this huge insect to shred food and transport hunted animals from one place to another. Also roaming the marshy undergrowth was Orthopleura, a monstrous but peaceful 2.5-meter-long millipede that fed on decaying vegetables. A creature that unfortunately became extinct in the early Permian as the climate became drier. Scholars have often wondered why certain Carboniferous period animals were so large. The way oxygen was diffused through their respiratory systems should have put an upper limit on their size. Then it was discovered that the Carboniferous atmosphere had an oxygen concentration of 35%, which is much higher than today's 20%. And it is this abundance that allowed Meganeura and other insects to develop well beyond their present size. Amphibians, the dominators of the Carboniferous, had also differentiated and enlarged in the early Permian, but they had a limitation. They had to remain near water for their entire lives to keep their skins moist and to reproduce. But the Permian saw the explosion of reptiles, new animals with waterproof skin, and most importantly, whose eggs had a solid shell that could resist drying up by the sun. The Permian was a period of general regression of the seas and desertification of land masses, so that newcomers spread to replace amphibians in almost every ecological niche. Thus began an unchallenged dominance that would last 200 million years. The link between amphibians and reptiles was the Cimoria, a species of squat lizard that measured about 60 centimeters in length, and although it was an amphibian, it already laid hard-shelled eggs. Based on current evidence, the first true reptile, however, must be considered Hylominus, whose fossils have been found in sediments dating back 315 million years. Hylominus, whose name in Greek means forest dweller, may have been the first tetrapod, four-legged animal, to lay eggs and to have a scaly skin, features that would have allowed it to venture even far from the bodies of water to which its amphibian ancestors were instead bound. It must have had a lizard-like exterior as well as habits and size. Before long, the first group of evolved reptiles, the Pelicosaurs, was characterized. These creatures appeared towards the end of the Carboniferous period and persisted until the Permian, dominating the continents for about 40 million years. Among the herbivorous Pelicosaurs, one of the most widespread was the Edaphosaurus, which lived between 300 and 280 million years ago. With lengths ranging from half a meter to 3.5 meters, their weight, in the largest species, could exceed 300 kilograms. Their most striking feature was the large dorsal tail, formed by membranous tissue stretched over the very long extensions of the dorsal vertebrae. By far the most famous Pelicosaurus, often mistaken for a dinosaur, however, is Dimetrodon, which lived between 295 and 272 million years ago. Unlike Edaphosaurus, Dimetrodon was a carnivore, probably the most powerful and dangerous predator of its time. The name, of Greek origin, means teeth of two sizes. Dimetrodons, in fact, possessed incisor-like teeth and other canine-like teeth. That is, they were heterodonts, like humans, with teeth specialized in different functions, a characteristic that reptiles in general, e.g. crocodiles, did not possess, having teeth of different sizes but all the same shape. Numerous species of Dimetrodon have existed, ranging in size from a minimum of 60 centimeters to a maximum of 4.6 meters. They could weigh up to 250 kilograms. Recent studies on the conformation of the spinal extensions of the dorsal vertebrae of Dimetrodons indicate that the bony end was probably not covered by the sail. Surely, however, the sail covered much of these bony spurs, providing a primitive but effective thermoregulation system. Surprisingly, although its appearance and physiology made it resemble a reptile, Dimetrodon must be considered closely related to mammals, although not yet a direct ancestor of them. Yes, this may come as a surprise, but the time was ripe for the appearance of evolutionary features that over millennia would lead to a new class, the mammalian vertebrates. And all this happened even before dinosaurs came on the scene. The timing and sequence cannot be precisely defined, but paleontologists believe that during the early Permian period, a branch of Pelicosaurs evolved into reptiles called Therapsids, otherwise known as mammal-like reptiles. Therapsids were characterized by powerful jaws with sharper and better differentiated teeth, and they possessed features more similar to those of modern mammals. Their limbs were no longer lateral like those of reptiles, but developed vertically below the body. They were also heterodont, with three different types of teeth, incisors, canines, and molars, and some species were probably furred and warm-blooded. The first therapsids to spread widely at the expense of Pelicosaurs were the Dnocephalia, whose name means scary heads. The origin of the name is because the skulls of these animals had ridges, protuberances, and bony thickenings, which probably served for head-to-head fights for dominance and courtship. The Dinosaurs included herbivorous and carnivorous species. Herbivores were among the largest animals of their age. They could reach up to 5 meters in length and 2 tons in weight. The largest carnivorous Dinosaurs reached the same length but weighed no more than half a ton. Their large, heavy skulls measured as much as 80 centimeters long, and their mouths were armed with long, pointed canine-like teeth. The upper incisors had the characteristic of interlocking with the lower ones so that they tore through food like shears. One of the largest was the Moschops, a herbivore up to 5 meters long, with an extremely wide thorax and super large, massive bones. It had an extremely thick skull cap and a super strong spine, an ideal endowment for practicing his favorite sport, that of headbutting rivals. Even more evolved on the road that would lead to the appearance of the first true mammals was the Teriodont group, whose main representative was the Gorgonops, meaning Gorgon-like appearance, named after the monsters of Greek mythology. Indeed, the appearance of these animals must have been impressive. Standing tall on strong legs, Gorgonops were equipped with a large, elongated head and remarkable teeth. They were equipped with long, curved canines that in some forms resembled real sabers. Up to 4 meters long, Gorgonops are surely to be considered the most dangerous predators of their time. A time that ended suddenly, however, marking the extinction of almost all of these very strange creatures, when 252 million years ago, the Earth's core began to tremble. At first, it was an imperceptible tremor because it arose 80 or 100 or more kilometers deep, somewhere beneath the region corresponding to present-day Siberia. A massive hot spot began to form, with a flow of liquid rock erupting from the mantle and flooding the crust. But these were not the volcanic phenomena we are accustomed to. That is, mountains that after centuries of sleep exploded spewing ash and lava. They were no more or less than crevices miles and miles long spewing lava nonstop for years, decades, and centuries. The late Permian eruption lasted a few hundred thousand years, perhaps millions. There were periods of violent activity and quieter periods of slower flow. Overall, the lava that surfaced in northern and central Asia inundated several million square kilometers of land. And that's not all. When a volcano erupts, it not only ejects lava, but also heat, dust, and toxic gases that, unlike lava, affect the environmental conditions of the entire planet. Thus, it was that, at the end of the Permian, a destructive domino effect was triggered that lasted millions of years and irrevocably changed the world. Dust splashed into the atmosphere, contaminated high-altitude air currents, and spread everywhere, shielding sunlight and hindering plant photosynthesis. Lush carnivorous forests died. Large herbivores were left without plants to eat, and as a result, carnivores such as the Gorgonospids were without prey. The food chain broke down. Some dust mixed with the water and fell from the sky in the form of acid rain that worsened the already serious situation on the ground. The disappearance of plants had rendered it barren and unstable, subject to massive erosion and the influence of waves of mud that swept away whole tracts of now rotting forests. Fires broke out on the scarred ground, making it even more difficult for plants and animals to survive. These were the short-term effects, visible within a few days, weeks, or months after the eruption of lava from Siberian cracks. The long-term and very long-term fallout was even more deadly. Along with the lava, oppressive clouds of carbon dioxide came out of the ground. Today, alas, we know full well that carbon dioxide is a powerful greenhouse gas that absorbs radiation in the atmosphere and reflects it back to the Earth's surface, heating it up. The CO2 spewed from the Siberian eruptions did more than just raise the temperature by a degree or two. It unleashed a resounding greenhouse effect that made the planet boil. But there were other consequences, because in addition to the atmosphere, the carbon dioxide went into the oceans, triggering a chain of chemical reactions that made the water more acidic, a big problem, especially for sea creatures with easily soluble shells. Kind of us like bathing in vinegar. The chain reaction also deprived the oceans of much oxygen, another serious problem for those living in or near water. In what paleontologists bluntly call a mass extinction, 90% of living species disappeared. Then, as always, the situation improved. Life is resilient, and even after the worst of catastrophes, there are always some species that make it through. After a few million years of eruptions, the hotspot lost power and died out. Gradually, with no more of the evil influence of lava, dust, and carbon dioxide, ecosystems were able to stabilize. Plants began to grow and diversify again, to feed herbivores that in turn fed carnivores. Food webs were reconstituted. It took at least 5 million years for the recovery to become established, after which the world was better but different. On the shores of the lakes, there were no longer giant dragonflies. Pareiasaurus and their kin, the survivors, had a half-empty Earth all to themselves, a frontier to colonize. The Permian had given way to another geological area, the Triassic. In a new world, dinosaurs were about to enter the scene.